explanation is underseen.
Quick video here. Last night we had problems with the audio when I showed a video clip just to show the text of Devin Nunes' conversation at a donor function. It went out simply because the program that I use cuts out the audio from the microphone while you show the video, and I just didn't figure that one out. So that's my fault. But in any case, I wanted to go over what I did say last night because I thought this was important. At least I'll try to remember what I said. But in any case, here we have the text of that recording. So we have Devin Nunes saying, "So therein lies." So it's like your classic catch-22 situation. We were at a, this puts us in a tough spot. If Sessions won't unrecuse, well, first of all, How would Sessions unrecuse himself? That seems impossible. But he knows that he can't be, he won't change. Sessions himself is in trouble. So it says, if Sessions won't unrecuse and Mueller won't clear the president, well, why would he? Okay. Why would he? He's a subject of the investigation. He's just not going to clear him like Trump wants. We're the only ones. So we can see here that Nunes believes that the House is the only one that can save the president. It says, which is really the danger. That's why I keep, and thank you for saying it, by the way, I mean we have to keep all these seats. We have to keep the majority. If we do not keep the majority, all of this goes away. So, of course, he's talking about the November election. And if they lose the election, then that would mean that it would put Trump in jeopardy. He goes on. They know it's ridiculous to go after the president for obstruction of justice. But if they tell a lie often enough and they put it out there and they say, oh, we're looking at the tweets because, you know, we got a mixed bag on the tweets, right? Like sometimes you love the president's tweets. Sometimes we cringe on the president's tweets. And of course, Trump's not going to like that. But they're trying to make a political. This is all political as to why the story ran in the New York Times on the tweets. So he says, they know it's ridiculous to go after the president for obstruction of justice. That's ridiculous in itself. He goes on. Now, if somebody thinks that my campaign or Kathy's campaign, now Kathy's the one who's receiving the funds, she's obviously running for Congress, is colluding with the Chinese. Now, of course, he's using the word Chinese. He's not going to use Russian, but he's basically making an analogy to Russia. Now, if somebody thinks that my campaign or Kathy's campaign is colluding with the Chinese, or you name the country, hey, could happen. It would be a very bad thing if Kathy was getting secrets from the Portuguese. Let's say, just because I'm Portuguese, my family was. So Kathy was getting secret information from the Portuguese. You know, may or may not be unusual. But ultimately, let's say the Portuguese came and brought her some stolen emails. And she decided to release those. Okay, now we have a problem, right? Well, that's the president's problem. Okay, we all know it. He was on television the night where he said, Russia, if you can hear me, find those 30,000 emails. Okay, now I didn't state that verbatim, but it's essentially what he did there. And that's essentially almost conspiracy in itself, because that night they went after her emails. And she decided to release those. Okay, now we have a problem, right? Because somebody stole the emails, gave them to Kathy. Kathy released them. Well, if that's the case, then that's criminal, which essentially is what's happening with the president. So somebody in the audience says, but also on things that came up in the House on Rosenstein impeachment thing, and it appears from an outsider that the Republicans were not supported. Nunes then says, yeah, well, so it's a bit complicated, right? And I say that because you have to, so we only have so many months left, right? So if we actually vote to impeach, now they're talking about Rosenstein here, impeaching Rosenstein. Okay, what does that mean is that triggers the Senate then has to take it up. So in other words, if they decide to impeach Rosenstein, Senate has to take it up. And now they have a problem because they want to put Kavanaugh in the Supreme Court, and they wouldn't have the time or the focus. Well, and you have to decide what you want right now, because the Senate only has so much time. Do you want them to drop everything and not confirm the Supreme Court justice, the new Supreme Court justice, who's going to try to obviously get Trump off? At least that's my opinion. So that's part of why I don't think you're not getting from, and I've said publicly, Rosenstein deserves to be impeached. No, he doesn't deserve to be impeached. You want him impeached so they can close the investigation. That's all you want, Nunes. I mean, so I don't think you're going to get any argument from most of our colleagues. The question is the timing of it right before the election. The Senate would have to start. The Senate would have to drop everything they're doing and to start with the impeachment on Rosenstein, and then take a risk of not getting Kavanaugh confirmed. So it's not a matter of any of us like Rosenstein. It's a matter of timing. So there you see it. Okay. This is the only thing that the House Intelligence Committee is doing is trying to protect the president. That's it. There's your coup right there. It has nothing to do with protecting the Constitution. By the way, you'll have to excuse me with the green screen. I'm using OBS, and as the light changes outside, we're having a bit of a problem with the light flicker. But you get my point. So I'm going to stop with that, with Nunes. I just again want to say that this is exactly what I'm talking about. The Republican House members are essentially in a situation where they have a coup because they're out to protect the president. And that goes along with Frank Lobiondo, my congressman, a congressman to whom I wrote about a month ago. You all saw it on the Reality Report. Didn't get anything back from him. Okay, they've done nothing. Zero. Okay, they're out to protect the president. Okay? They might get away with it too. Next, I'll be talking about Judge Ellis. So I'm going to stop this recording. You won't really see much in terms of the transition, but to Judge T.S. Ellis. Okay, this comes from the Washington Post. The federal judge overseeing the Paul Manafort trial took another shot at Special Counsel Robert Mueller's team Thursday afternoon, even after conceding earlier in the day that the criticism he leveled at prosecutors on Wednesday was erroneous. The prosecution spent about 40 minutes Thursday afternoon questioning a bank employee about Manafort's unsuccessful effort to get a $5.5 million construction loan on a Brooklyn brownstone, only to have Judge Ellis III suggest that the issue was unworthy of such extensive discussion on the trial. Notably, Ellis made the remark with the jury present. And this is what I'm talking about, or I did talk about last night, that the judge is berating the prosecution in front of the jurors, which is already going to tilt it in the defense's direction. So it says, you might want to spend some time on the loan that was granted, the judge scoffed at Prosecutor Uzo Asanye sat down after concluding his questioning of Citizens Bank employee Taryn Rodriguez. That prompted Asanye, who had sat down, to jump back up. Your Honor, this is a charged count in the indictment. I know that, Ellis shot back. This tense exchange was just the latest example of Ellis making comments that could lead jurors to question the prosecution's case or its tactics in the tax and bank fraud trial that happened. So again, he's essentially putting his hand on the scales right there because, you know, you have Bubis Americanus in the juror seats, most likely, okay? And they're going to just look at the nonverbals and the verbals of the judge and think that the prosecutor's out of hand. Okay? So it says, as we go on, Ellis even acknowledged that one of his prior remarks was out of line. This is after the fact, of course. Telling the jury early Thursday that he may well have been wrong the day before he was slammed, when he slammed the Mueller team for allowing an expert witness from the IRS to remain in the courtroom while other witnesses were testifying. Typically, witnesses aren't supposed to hear anyone else's testimony in a trial, so they don't influence each other. But Mueller's team got Ellis' permission during the trial's opening arguments last week to have the IRS agent in the court on a regular basis. "This robe doesn't make me anything other than human," Ellis told the court on Thursday morning after instructing the jury to forget what he had said to the Mueller team about the IRS witness. "You've got to put that aside." Well, that's easier said than done, okay? What he should have done is taken the jury and put them in a separate room, sequestered them in a separate room, and then spoke to the prosecutor. But he didn't do that. And this has been going on and on and on with this case. This is just one example that the Washington Post showed. And again, you saw from the text there that it was the prosecution's right to have that expert from the IRS there. Okay, that was already agreed upon. So again, these jury members see this judge getting exasperated with the prosecution, and that doesn't help, you know, unless somebody's keen and kind of understands that, you know, this judge is tipping the scales. Now, the only way to make this even is if he does the same thing to the defense. And luckily, you know, the news services, for example, MSNBC, CNN, they're covering this. The papers are covering it. So he knows he's under the microscope. So hopefully something will be done. But I don't know. I am very, very concerned about this. And I see it, at least what I've seen so far, is something in favor of the defense. And I wouldn't be surprised if Manafort gets out of this thing. Because remember, they've got to have all 12 to agree. And if one person goes the other way, one boobus goes the other way, that's it. And it's because of things like this, with this judge who berates the prosecution, you know, it's going to put it in their minds that the prosecution's wrong already. No matter what said, it's not going to matter. It's kind of like a commercial. You know, your attention is directed the first 5 seconds and the last 5 seconds, and this guy pulls this kind of shit. Yeah, it's no good. It's no good. So these two examples, the Nunes example and the Ellis example, just shows you what we have going up against us in this country right now. This is serious business. We all know that there are shenanigans, but this is just so explicitly true. I mean, you just have to look at it and you see what's going on here. Again, excuse me for the green screen. I don't have time. I have to get to work in a few minutes, and I just wanted to get this out there. And again, the lighting during the day changes constantly as this, you know, the sun moves across the sky, and you're going to see some this and that, as I see already. But to hell with it, because we have to get this out. So anyway, this is just an addendum to last night's video. Wanted to make sure that I made my point.